want to be closer to the Lord tonight. By the time you leave, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, that's our desire, and that's certainly why we're here tonight. This next song is entitled "We Will Go Up," and it's really based on the Psalms of Ascent that the children of Israel would sing in the Old Testament. See, Jerusalem being located on a hill, anywhere you would approach to get to Jerusalem from the north, south, east, or west, you had to go up to get there. And so they would sing these psalms, called Psalms of Ascent, on the way. And these psalms would remind them how God had been good to them as a people, how He had been faithful to them, how He provided for them. Similar to if you hop in the car and you're driving to church this Sunday morning, you may put a praise music tape on and just let your heart and minds be captivated by that. That's what they were doing. Well, we may not be moving physically up tonight, but it's certainly our desire that by the time we leave, we find ourselves on a higher plane with Jesus than ever before. Amen? Let's go up together. Side to side, He can only nod his head up and down. And so this owner said, well, there's probably a buck to be made here somewhere. So he would travel around with this circus and this elephant, and he would challenge people for a dollar a try. They could come up and try to make the elephant move his head like this. And if they could do it, he'd give them a $100 prize. Well, no one was very successful. I mean, people would come up and then holler at the poor beast, then scream at him, then pull his tail, you know, flap his ears, all this, to no avail. I mean, the elephant could do this number, but he could not do this. And one old farmer got really disgusted and took a shovel that he found lying nearby and came up under the elephant and just smacked him in the stomach as hard as he could and just walked away. Well, a year later, same circus, same owner, same elephant, same farmer back in that Midwestern town. And the farmer comes up to the elephant after paying his dollar due, takes him by the ear, gently whispers and says, "Do you remember me?" The elephant said. And the farmer said, "You want me to do it again?" Elephant. See, we're like the elephant. When somebody hurts us, we don't forget. And yet, Scripture says that God, when He forgives, He also forgets. Why is that? Has God got a bad memory? No, of course not. What it is because at the cross, God has chosen to forget your sins and mine. He has chosen to remember them no more. He throws them, Scripture says, as far as the east is from the west. I have a feeling there are probably more than a couple of us tonight who are hanging on to grudges and past hurts, past failures. Remember, God forgives and He forgets.
Thank you.
Trust me, we're not espousing some sort of lame philosophy here. You know, I believe that if God, you know, wants to bless me with a Porsche and four houses on the hills or whatever, that he's obligated to do so right now. That's not the object. But we really believe that a yielded heart to the Lord Jesus is the one in which he wants to move in and make entrance into their life and begin to make changes right now. What would keep some of you from being changed into the image of Jesus right now?
Thank you.
know, it's easy to celebrate when things are going well and times are great in our lives. It's easy to, relatively easy to thank the Lord and say, God, you just blessed me with so much. What about the hard times? What about the trials, the tribulations? What about the darkest hour of the night in your life? Do you find yourself thanking God as much then? Well, probably most of us don't. The truth is, God is still God, and He's still being good, even in the tough times. For every mountain, for every valley you've ever walked through, God has been nothing but good to you.
Thank you.
five words. You don't have to forget it. You don't have to forget it. See, those of us who have sinned much with our lives, we've been forgiven greatly because there was much that we forgave. You know, it's our heart's desire as a church, I know we share this with the pastor, that this place always be a place where people can come. A place to be accepted, loved on, a place where people can come to be understood, a place where healing can begin to happen in our lives. Maybe it's physical healing, maybe it's spiritual, maybe it's emotional, mental. It may always be said about Woodridge Baptist Church, no, not that they're great church, I have a lot of fun. That's great. We want that. May it always be a place where Jesus is the head. May it always be a place where we're healing of all kinds in our person's life.
Thank you.
been good to you. Let just thankfulness just overflow out of your heart to the Lord as we sing.
Thank you.
ups and the downs, through the mountains and the valleys. Our God is a good God. The world does not always understand that. It doesn't negate the truth. Our God is so good and so worthy to be trusted in. During these next few moments, as you hear these poignant stories of trusting in God's goodness, let your heart rejoice and continue to consider the ways He's been good to you.
About 6 years ago, I didn't think life could get any better for me than it was right then. I was living in my hometown, working in a business that I had helped to build for 10 years. The business was doing well, reputation was growing within the industry for the business and for myself. And I can remember standing in the parking lot thinking, I have no reason to ever leave here. Life is great. And just a few weeks later, my boss decided that I just wasn't the man for the job anymore. So he moved me across the hall, and I got to watch somebody else walk into my office, sit at my desk, and in about 6 weeks, almost destroy everything that I had built in 10 years. At the end of that 6 weeks, I was restored back to my position. I had the opportunity to put back the things that were broken, to try and fix the things that I had spent that 10 years building. But what God had done for me in that 6 weeks of extremely dark times when I just didn't know what He was doing was to begin to cut the ties for me. Because in 10 years, that business had become a part of me. It was almost like trying to raise a child. And in that 6 week period, He was telling me, this child is going to be fine without you. I have somewhere else for you to go. He opened doors, He moved our family to Florida, and the family flourished. And after about 5 years in Florida, again, I was thinking, you know what? Life just doesn't get any better than this. I could stay here forever. Things are great. And God said, hey, guess what? It's time to move. And He brought us here about 9 months ago. And when I look back, 6 years ago where we were, and where He has brought us today, I know that He has blessed us greatly, far and above anything I could have thought of when I thought the world was great. He had to walk us through some dark times to get us here. And there were hard times along the way. But what He's taught me is that even in the dark times, I can trust Him. He has a plan. He knows what He's doing. And He has been good to me.
Just to take Spirit came upon me, and I was able to look at my tormentors and greet them in their native accent.
He has drawn me closer and closer to him through Christian friends, through music, and through praise and worship. I've learned the more that I magnify God, the more I lift him up, the smaller my problem appears. And even though with my natural eyes I cannot see a change in my situation, I know I serve a supernatural God, and he's working his plan, and he's with me every step of the way. And I can say, no matter what happens to me, he has been good to me.
Just back on that time in my life, there are still many painful and frustrating memories.
but I wouldn't change any of it because God changed me. I'm stronger now. I'm not afraid. And I don't worry about what the future has in store for me. I know from my experience that God has been good to me. And no matter what happens in my life, God will always be good to me.
Yet in the future.